Once there was a miller who was very poor, but he had a beautiful daughter. Now it so happened that he had occasion to speak with the king, and in order to give himself an air of importance, he said, "Your Majesty, I have a daughter who can spin gold out of straw." The king said to the miller, "That is indeed an art in which I am much interested. Now, if your daughter is as skillful as you say she is, bring her to my castle tomorrow, and I will put her to the test." Accordingly, when the girl was brought to the castle, the king conducted her to a chamber, which was quite full of straw, and gave her a spinning wheel and a reel, and said, "Now set to work, and if between tonight and tomorrow at dawn you have not spun this straw into gold, you must die." Thereupon he carefully locked the door of the chamber, and she remained alone. There sat the unfortunate miller's daughter, and for the life of her didn't know what to do. She had not the least idea how to spin straw into gold, and she became more and more distressed, until at last she began to weep. And then, all at once, the door sprang open, and in stepped a little man who said, "Good evening, Mistress Miller, good evening. Oh, what are you weeping for?" "Alas," answered the maiden, "I've got to spin gold out of straw, and I don't know how to do it." And the little man said, "What will you give me if I spin it for you?" "My necklace," said the maiden. The little man took the necklace, sat down before the spinning wheel, and in a trice the reel was full. Then he fixed another reel and thrice round, and that too was full. And so it went on until morning, when all the straw was spun and all the reels were full of gold. Immediately at sunrise, the king came, and when he saw the gold, he was astonished and very much pleased indeed, but his mind became only the more avaricious. So he had the miller's daughter taken to another chamber full of straw, larger than the former one, and he ordered her to spin it also in one night if she valued her life. The maiden was at her wit's end and began to weep. Again the door sprang open and the little man appeared and said, "What will you give me if I spin the straw into gold for you?" "The ring off my finger," answered the maiden. The little man took the ring, began to work again at the wheel, and by morning had spun all the straw into gold. The king was delighted at the sight of the masses of gold, but was not even yet satisfied. So he had the miller's daughter taken to a still larger chamber full of straw and said, "This must you spin tonight into gold, but if you succeed this time, you shall become my queen." "Even if she's only a miller's daughter," thought he, "I shan't find a richer woman in the world." And when the girl was alone, the little man came again and said for the third time, "Beautiful maiden, what will you give me if I spin the straw for you this time?"
"Well, I have nothing more to give," answered the girl.
"Well, promise me your first child, if you become queen."
"Who knows what may happen," thought the miller's daughter, but she did not see any other way of getting out of the difficulty, so she promised the little man what he demanded, and in return, the little man spun the straw into gold once more.
When the king came in the morning and found everything as he had wished, he celebrated his marriage with her, and the miller's daughter became indeed the queen.
But a beautiful child was born, but the queen had forgotten all about the little man. However, he suddenly entered her chamber and said, "Now, your majesty, come, give me what you promised."
The queen was terrified, and she offered the little man all the wealth of the kingdom if he would only let her keep the child. But the little man said, "No, no, indeed. I would rather have some living thing than treasures of the world."
Then the queen began to moan and to weep to such an extent that the little man felt sorry for her. Very well. I will give you 3 days, said he. And if within that time you can discover my name, you shall keep the child. Then during the night, the queen called to mind all the names that she had overheard, and she sent a messenger all over the country to inquire far and wide what other names there were. And when the little man appeared the next day, she began with Caspar, Melchior, Balthazar, and mentioned all the names which she knew one after the other. But at every one, the little man said, no, 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 not my name, not my name, not my name. The second day she had inquiries made all round the neighborhood for the names of people living there, and suggested to the little man all the most unusual and strange names. Perhaps your name is Cow Ribs, or Spindle Shanks, or perhaps Spider Legs. But he again answered, no, 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 not my name, not my name, not my name. On the third day, the messenger came back and said, I haven't been able to find any new names. But as I came round the corner of a wood on a lofty mountain, Your Majesty, where the fox says good night to the hare, I saw a little house. And in front of the little house, a fire was burning. And around the fire, a most ridiculous little man was leaping. He was hopping on one leg, singing, today I bake, tomorrow I brew my beer, the next day I'll bring the queen's child over here. Ha ha, luck it is that not a soul doth know that Rumpelstiltskin is my name. Ho ho, ho ho, ho ho, ho ho. Well, you can imagine how delighted the queen was when she heard the name. And soon afterwards, when the little man came in and asked, now, Your Majesty, what is my name? At first she asked, is your name Tom? Nope. Is it Dick? Nope. Is it by any chance Rumpelstiltskin? Ah, the devil told you that, the devil told you that, the devil told you that, shrieked the little man. And in his rage, he stamped his right foot into the ground so deep that he sank up to his waist. And then, in his rage, he seized his left leg with both hands and tore himself asunder in the middle. There now.